Glad to welcome everyone on our final webinar about Master Program Economics and Economic Policy. And today we're going to speak about the track Behavioral Economics. And it is actually our innovation compared to the previous programs. We have only one course, Behavioral Economics, but starting from the upcoming year, we decided to have a special track for those who are interested in behavioral features. And I'm really glad to welcome Alexis Belianin, who will be a mentor of the track, with whom you're going to be in contact during 2 years, and who is going to help you to structure your educational plan, actually. So the screen is yours, Alexis. We're really waiting to hear peculiarities of the behavioral economics and some other, I think, interesting points about the track.
Okay, great, Elena. Thank you very much, Elena. Thank you very much, Oksana, for inviting me to this presentation, and welcome everyone. Have a good afternoon, evening, morning, whatever time zone you are currently in. And I'm going to speak not only on behalf of myself, but also on behalf of a team of people who would be teaching and different courses and interacting with your supervisors and work on different aspects of behavioral economics, experimental economics, and related policy research issues. So I'm going to say a few words about how the program is different. Maybe what are the peculiar features of this program? What is it different from the conventional economics programs, and what behavioral economics actually are doing? We start from looking at a simple person, such as this young lady on the screen, who is definitely making an economic decision, right? We probably all agree with that. She is trying to find out the best good in the supermarket, right? This lady allegedly is trying to do something very similar. And economists would ask a good question: which of these ladies is likely to make a better decision, be more rational, if you want, this one or that one? And conventional economics, we may have, of course, we may look at the faces of ladies and imagine, well, this lady probably is more thoughtful, but also she may be more forgetful. That's why she has a list in front of her, but she's better prepared. So maybe there are different levels of rationality in the eyes of this lady can be read versus what you can anticipate from that lady. But the economic theory says that the second lady probably connects in front of her in the notepad, trying to figure out the best good combination of goods she wants to buy. But if you are really well trained economist, you might imagine that this lady might have something like that in her notepad, which is a conventional optimization problem. This constant resistor substitution utility function, and she might be able to solve that problem before making a decision. But of course, you know, people are not usually walking in the supermarkets with something like that or even like that in their notepads, right? This lady probably is making decisions on different grounds. She's thinking about what would be suitable, what would be not suitable. You may anticipate what is she doing, but in fact, it's difficult to understand what this person is doing, what she's thinking about. It's difficult to understand for ourselves how to make a good decision. It's difficult to understand the behavior of other people, maybe more difficult than our own, because who knows what happens to their mind, who can read the minds of the other person. It's even more difficult to understand how individual decisions result in social outcomes. After all, societies are doing something by will and by force of what constituent members of the society are doing. But policy relevant question is, how can we affect and improve social outcomes, given what we know about what people are doing and how people behave, right? And above all, what are the techniques, the research techniques, which would help us to analyze all that, to understand the rationality or the thoughts behind each decision of a single individual, their anticipation of what they expect from each other in an interaction, the rule by which social outcomes are formed out of individual decisions, and using all that to propose some policy relevant ways to improve social outcomes. And it turns out that the many practical questions stem out of these simple problems, right? For instance, the efficiency of vaccination in preventing the pandemics of COVID-19, how effective would that be? That's a practical question, and the efficiency would depend on social reaction to vaccination, right? Because if society is willing to spread over the, or to apply for getting vaccinated, it's one thing, but some societies may have opponents to this idea of vaccination, and the opponents may be explicit, but may be hidden. People don't vaccinate you, but the government doesn't observe why. Then what would force them? What would incentivize them to go through vaccination? Simple behavioral again, in nature problem. If a manager of a firm, an owner of the firm, tends to raise salary to the employees, would that result in higher productivity? Government may ask a question: is web-based tax payment system, for instance, an efficient way to increase tax compliance? If the taxpayers don't have to go to the tax office, but may just online fill out their declarations, would that result in better tax discipline or not? Policymakers may be concerned about how to reduce mortality in traffic accidents. For instance, would the reduction of speed result in lower mortality? Of course, on the one hand, yes. On the other hand, some drivers may be not happy about that policy measure, and some drivers who are very careless probably will not be afraid of larger fines for speed violation. It may not result in lowering mortality rates. So the question is, which policy measure would be effective given the behavioral response of people to that policy measure? That's why answering these questions, in fact, what we need to do, we need to curve and use experiments. You'll know that experiments in natural sciences are canonical thing. If you are curious enough, or if you have a broad education in natural sciences, you probably remember what was a Sir Isaac Newton's prism experiment, which is a canonical example and a very beautiful experiment, really, which was back in 17th century. Of course, it was kind of not so obvious. Physics was young science, and economics was non-existent. But Sir Isaac Newton has proposed a very nice way to answer the question: is it the case that the color of light is borrowed from the properties of the substances through which the light passes? Is it the case or not? That was a hypothesis prevalent at the time, and that experiment shows that no, this is not the case. Color of lights are embedded in the white light itself. And that's basically how he proved that. And incidentally, Sir Isaac Newton, who is a theorist, as we know, right, when studying science, examples are more useful than the rules. So he was a great fan of experiments, and of course, not only him, from that very sense, because experiments explain you and they give you a sharp answer to the question why, to the why question. Why something which happens? Why, what is the cause and what are the consequences of particular actions? And in human sciences, experiments also take place. Field experiments, this is not anymore an agricultural phenomenon, it's a phenomenon typical of economics, right? Because besides studying some behavior in a narrowed down conditions of the laboratory, economists can go to the field and look how particular changes in real life affect particular decisions we observe in real life. And the technique behind that is the same, because you may apply some experimental conditions or treatments to large population of people, right? Some people can be in a control group. They are not affected by any kind of experimental intervention. And some people are affected by the intervention. And if people are randomly split up into these two groups, and we observe that the intervention results in an effect, for instance, more people become green in the intervention than in the control group, then we can formally claim that there is a causal relationship between our intervention and the behavioral outcome which we observe. In this case, it's a question whether particular intervention can help people to find a job in a more easier way. But of course, you can think of many other experiments similar in nature. And what we eventually look after, we look after the confirmation or rejection of the hypothesis that if we intervene, as a red line shows here at this point, this point shown by the vertical line, then the outcome plotted by the red line, treatment group will be higher than the comparable changes in outcome in the control group, which has not been treated. And all these things are, of course, it's very simple on the graph, but it's not so simple in reality, because this what happens to this control group and treatment group, of course, is not always observable. There are lots of difficulties how to properly analyze the control for many other circumstances which might affect the outcome behind our intervention. So there are a lot of issues around. It's not as easy to do in practice as it might seem in the graph. However, what we run economic experiments. And economic experiments are a very simple thing, basically. This is our games, but not games played by little children like that. These are games played in classrooms, other classrooms. Like this is one of the examples of an experimental laboratory, which is a lab. And we have a similar lab in Pokrovka, our campus now. And when people sit in the these cubicles, make economic decisions in front of the computers, like these guys are doing here. And we observe the outcomes of their decisions in theoretically unambiguous circumstances. Just to give you a couple of examples, what experiments may look like. A canonical example of an ultimatum game is that there are two people, right? One person has a pie, a resource, for instance, this nice piece of cheese. And he or she can share this resource with another guy. But this propose any particular part of this pie to the other guy, and the other guy will say yes or no. And depending on the answer of the second guy, if the second guy says yes, then this is the allocation which is implemented. If the second guy says no, then both participants receive zero. Now question, how much will the should the rational first guy propose to the second guy, and how much would the second guy accept or not accept out of this proposal? If you have received some training in game theory, that's an easy exercise. Of course, you would easily figure out that the second guy should accept any tiny bit of the cheese, right? Because accepting an epsilon tiny bit is better than getting nothing. And as a result, this guy has no reason to offer to that guy more than this epsilon. So the equilibrium prediction, in fact, is zero offer. Or if you want it to be certain, offer the blue guy should offer to the red one an epsilon, and the red one should accept, and the blue guy will get the whole pie. Okay, it is not what happens in reality, because in reality, if you look at the experimental evidence, this is taken from a paper in 1994, but a long time ago, you see the division of the pie is closer to equal to ultimatum in ultimatum game conditions here, and also closer to equal in dictator game conditions, when the second guy has no voice at all. Second guy just accepts whatever the first guy wanted to give him. And in fact, in Russia, we observe similar things. We have run such an experiment in several cities of Russia, and you see the in ultimatum game, the offers are around 50%, or maybe sometimes even more. And even in dictator game, the blue bars, they are okay, lower than in ultimatum, but very similar. And anticipations, the green bars, are also similar. So basically, the economic prediction of conventional theory fails here. People are much more generous than offering zero. Another example, which is also canonical and relevant in many cases, a trust game. The trust game runs between two players, and essentially, it's a model of cooperation in the society. The first person has the money, the second person has an idea, capitalist and entrepreneur. If a capitalist gives money to the entrepreneur can realize it and can make profit out of the money he or she receives from the investor. Right? Say investor has 10 units of money. If he passes that to the trustee, second player, the money triples, second guy receives 30. But now the second guy can cheat and grab everything, leaving zero to the first guy, or can share it equally, 50-50, for instance, 15, 15, 10, 15 here. Again, if you know some game theory, the equilibrium prediction is going to be no trust. People shall not trust each other. Why? Because the second guy has incentives to cheat, and the first guy will receive either zero here or 10 here if he gives nothing to the second player. Of course, the first guy prefers keeping the money in this case. Is it what you would observe in reality? Well, we have implemented that game in whole Russia, in all Russia, in 12 cities all over the country. And we found that the level of trust is much higher than the prediction of zero, over 50% in fact. And it's much higher in fact than what the survey data tells us. So in Russia, people are more trusted than you might expect, and also a bit less trustworthy. So the return rates shown here in blue are a bit lower than 50%, but still they are higher than 33, which the first guys would have received if they would not. It is, of course, a percentage, of course, of the whole pie, right? So for 44 corresponds to 44%, for instance, of a pie of 30, right? So if this share is more than one third, 33%, then the second guys return to the first guys more than the first guys would have received had they retained their money. So this is a rather high figures of trust. In fact, they are higher than what is observed internationally. So these are the things that you are going to address. And of course, a lot of technical things around that, and a lot of theories and a lot of economics, which is going behind all these things. Because what I might say is that we as behavioral economists, we are supposed to be universal soldiers. We should know economic theory, mathematics, statistics, and econometrics. We should know sociology, psychology, a bit of philosophy, anthropology, and should love traveling across the globe. And I have colleagues who are doing field experiments in Papua New Guinea, for instance, and they are doing experiments in the Russian Far East, and also in Arkhangelsk region, remote areas somewhere here. Where I've never been before, actually. So there are a lot of things that you should be open to. And the domain of what we are doing ranges from cognitive neuroscience, when people scan brains of humans to understand what are the mental correlates or determinants of particular decisions, to field experiments which show how a particular policy intervention affects the behavior of communities and the whole country. We should know, again, have a background in social sciences to understand how to frame properly the design. And we should have a background in programming, because our software is, we program it also ourselves. And we should know how to build up an app which would be used in the lab or offline in order to observe people, to collect decisions and match people's decisions with each other, if it's an interactive experiment. So the program which we are now describing will be based or constructed around all these and many more topics, of course, and it shall be good for you if you are interested in understanding human behavior, including yourself, gnosis theauton, as the ancient Greeks used to say, know yourself, understand yourself, right? If you are willing to explore interdisciplinary phase of economics, ranging from biology sometimes to data science, and from philosophy to mathematics. If you want to develop your programming skills, because our experiments are modeled and analyzed using programming software. And if you look after some interesting applications, something really which is of your interest, because you are puzzled about something in the world around you, this program will be for you. And of course, if you are not afraid working with real people, date and serious questions, that is a real work. This program is not good for if you are wanted to go easy. Behavioral economics, no matter what you might think, is not a collection of funny stories. It's an academic discipline. And academic rigor should go above all when you are to study behavioral economics. Making money, well, at least not directly, I have to be precise here, because if you are an economic subject experiment, if you go to our lab and participate in an economic experiment, then you will be making real money. We pay you for your economic decisions as incentives. But if you are interested in becoming a millionaire in next year after you graduate from this program, okay, some of you may happen to be a millionaire, some may not, because actually most will not become millionaires, I have to say that. It's not a financial program. Behavioral economists, they are good because they know what people are doing, but persuade and sell that knowledge to people who have real money is a separate task, and we shall be dealing a little bit with how to do that. But this is not an easy route. There is no guarantee that you will be a millionaire after you graduate from that program, at least in the short run. In the long run, you might well be. Going regular program is not good for going regular. It will now be full of surprises, and including economic experiments, including some real field work, including some participation in international scientific projects. We have many of them. And it's not good if you are trying to shy away of real people and real problems. You should be ready to deal with them. You should be ready to work with human subjects and with the communities, with the policymakers. And this is what we shall be preparing you for. And finally, the final thing I'm going to say is that there are going to be four or maybe five, the fifth course should be optional at the moment. Course on behavioral economics, appointed professor is Anton Suvorov. Experimental economics is Piotr Yevdokimov. Econometrics, that is econometrics for behavioral economics, is James Trimble. Behavioral policy is going to be taught by myself, and Philip Chopkowski is a leading world expert in all three. He's going to teach on experimental programming. So these are the people who should be around us. And you may want to look at our website, which features as a little advertisement. I probably shall switch to that thing now and show you some bits of what we have as our interface. Online, we have a variety of resources, starting from our website, which you hopefully can see now, when you can find plenty of resources which we have been working on, including, for instance, Yandex Toloka, which is the major resource which we are using now to run economic experiments. And here is a Russian interface, but you can program here many experiments in real time by setting up the special apps. But we connect them to the software which we write ourselves, and we receive people who make their decisions in real time from the crowdsourcing platform. And Yandex Toloka is one of the leading platforms in Russia which we are using very extensively, along with Amazon Mechanical Turk and Prolific, of course, right? Then we have many international events. The one large international conference which we co-organize in a sense, CRF and SABE, which is a leading convention of behavioral economists and economic psychologists in the world, which starts actually tomorrow. And but we are organizing two more international events. One is the International Summer School for the participants, for young researchers who are interested in experimental and behavioral economics. Another is for prominent keynote speakers. And another is a conference which we organize also this year, which shall take place in the second half of July, and which also attracts more than 50 world-class researchers, which will convene again online in Zoom. So if you are willing to attend this conference, please feel free to look at the website. Links are available on our website, and you could participate in that event as attendees. Unfortunately, not as speakers, because the list of accepted papers has been confirmed or approved right today. So it's for that we are late anyway. But there are many more things ahead for which you are not late. So if you are interested in behavioral economics and wanted to understand how individuals, groups, and societies make their economic decisions, welcome to the program and welcome to talk to us and to see and to interact with us in virtual and real space. Thank you very much. I think I have to stop here and answer your questions.
Thank you, Alexei. It was really interesting to hear, though I was familiar with most of your examples, but I really feel fascinated about behavioral economics, and I like it as an institutional one because it is really close to reality, and it is a really good opportunity, just to say, to touch real people, not just pure models. Mm-hmm. So is there any questions? Please type in chat.
I saw some already, I think.
No, there is some points about the sound, but I hear pretty well, so you will have an opportunity to listen, to watch a video afterwards if you have
some problems with
the sound. So is there any questions about this particular track, or maybe some general issues about the program?
Okay. Osman Masu, thank you very much. Well, that's nice to hear that. We hope that in our program we'll have many more things which would be much more exciting than what than the few words which I have spelled out, and this is half an hour. Okay.
Maybe I could shortly comment that this research tracker will also base on the main economic courses. So here it is the program of Master in Economics. So we suppose that everyone should attend courses on microeconomics, macroeconomics, econometrics, and even courses on Python. So all these skills should help you in running experiments and understanding better the courses that are particular to this track, the set that Alexei described above. Mm-hmm. Also, I think we can say that, we've got a question. Then I stop a little bit. Can you say more about career path after the graduation? Is it only academic field, or there are any applications of the knowledge in private sector?
Okay. Thank you, Igor, for a very good question. Yes, well, I have several answers to that question. One is that, of course, academic discipline means that behavioral economics is an exciting and rising part of academic economics. So there are a lot of applications in academia. Besides that, of course, there are at least two more areas when you can apply your knowledge and your skills. One is private sector. And in private sector, in fact, all marketing agencies and all sales departments are exercising behavioral economics without knowing that. Because advertising is behavioral economics because it appeals to our perception and appeals to our way of reasoning, to our ways of understanding the incentives and our ways to responding to that. Right? Different promotion campaigns are based on expected reaction of people to the interventions implemented by the company or the organizations which launches that. Right? Incentive schemes at work appeal to our incentives, again, incentives to respond to larger salary or non-monetary benefits. And right now, for instance, our lab has a project with a business company, with one of the largest Russian banks, where we develop a technique of profiling people's preferences towards risk. This is behavioral economics. So there are a lot of applications, and basically the members of our lab are delivering not only public lectures, but training to the various business companies based on behavioral knowledge and on how people respond to different incentives which they face in real life, and what kind of biases in their decisions which they may have, and how to on the one hand cope with these biases. I wouldn't say fight them, because it's a difficult thing, but cope with them and understand the limitations imposed by them. For you, it's important for you as the decision maker, but for the companies or for firms interacting with you, it's important to understand what you are, what you can be prone to in order to shape the product which would suit your interests the best. Finally, there are governments, which, as you probably have heard, the notion of behavioral nudges, right? In Russian, which has been coined again by behavioral economists, and which has been used extensively now by various governments of the country. In fact, it's more and more difficult to find a country where behavioral nudges never used in economic policy. In Russia, this is a little bit behind, I would say, but our interest to these measures is growing and is increasing year after year. So it's fair to assume that after your graduation, if you graduate from the program, and you would be willing to think about government service. In government service, behavioral public policy is an important tool of implementing the intended targets and in a relatively painless and relatively efficient way to raise the social welfare, at least. Behavioral economists can do that without making sharp and unpleasant decisions, which typically may receive very hostile welcome from the general public. Policymaker who is equipped with behavioral knowledge can achieve the same goals and maybe in a more efficient way without offending the recipients of this policy. So there is also a market here and a growing market in that direction in Russia. I hope I answered your question. But since it was focused on the private sector, I say yes, there are many applications of behavioral knowledge in private sector. Definitely. It's a short answer, but before I give a long one. Sorry about that. Yeah.
Yeah, and even there is no additional question, so I can add here that we also went through the articles that are dealing with the policy inside the companies, and it is the human resource departments, and they really worry about working conditions. And even before pandemic situation, they were dealing with the question whether what is better to work online, is it suitable to work from home, or you should keep all your workers closer to yourself? Mm-hmm. And big companies are really interested in these issues, and I see few papers in collaboration with the workers' representatives and the researchers about these issues. So here, I think that this field is practice and academic is really close to each other and doing a lot of collaborative work, that it is really nice. Because, you know, in some cases, economists say that you are too academic, you are far from reality, and here it's not true for sure, let's say. Also, I would like to advertise, though we have no questions, the opportunity to gain double degrees if you are interested in, so you could have 1 year outside high school of economics, it could be the second year, or you can have short visits for other universities and coming closer to this issue in the end of this first year. I think we with Alexei and our international department could search some appropriate programs that are also dealing with behavioral issues or experiments.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It seems that it is the final webinar, so most of the questions have already been answered.
Okay, some books. Okay, some books. What I may suggest at the moment is a very simple thing, is if you go to our website, we have a section on our publication. We have a section on our website. We should have a section, actually any a Russian section on the website, but books are in English anyway. Let me just switch and show you the link. There is a library in our website which features quite some sources which might be relevant and useful for experimental and behavioral economists. I'm just showing you the links. This link can be useful, I hope, for those who are interested in seeing some of the major sources in experimental and behavioral economics, and you hopefully know, of course, many of these books. We cite here the Russian versions of the books, but they are widely accessible everywhere. They're global books, of course, in English language books, and you can find the names in Amazon or in many other sources. So this is a list of books in experimental and behavioral economics. So I would suggest you first to look at this list, and once you cover that, look at the reference in these lists, look at some of the papers which we have on our website, which cite again some books and some sources. So this would be helpful, hopefully, for everyone interested in this area of research and of studies.
Maybe you could name some authors?
Yeah, the names are, if you just follow the link, you'll have links to the names and authors. That would be easy thing.
The most outstanding. For example, whether you suggest to start with Kahneman or
Daniel Kahneman, Thinking Fast and Slow is always nice. It's always nice. Then Ariely has a website, predictablyrational.com, which is also very nice. Maybe if you don't like long reading like Kahneman's book, look at Dan Ariely's website, which has sketches on three minutes video sketches, which explain you one or another behavioral paradox, largely based on his own and on his colleagues' works. And so it's very, very, very illuminating, really. If you want to look more deeply, there are of course many academic sources, but if you are interested in a particular topic, just feel free to drop me an email. I'll be happy to share with you some more specific information which might be of your interest. That would be also easy. Kahneman and Ariely are always good, and there are of course many more authors which could be no less insightful if you are interested in particular research. Yes, Richard Taylor's books are also very, very, very famous in these days. Yeah, like nudges. And the website is just above in the chat, right? So our lab website, which if you click at that website, you can find some links, but key names, I can drop them again in the chat.
I think we could also put the link on your library's website in the website of the program, just to give some idea about for those who are interested in what is behavioral economics and why it is interesting. Any other questions?
Yeah. Please.
Maybe you could say a few words about research project seminar, how you are gonna organize the work, because here we have one main seminar Maybe it sounds a little bit strange that other seminars, other tracks have a quite range of project proposed, and here only one. Whether it is, let's say, what is advantages and disadvantages of such approach? How do you see this?
Well, actually, we have a long experience of involvement of students in our research. Actually, graduates of our lab, I mean, just sort of notice that in the parentheses, they have entered postgraduate programs in such universities as Harvard, Columbia, Chicago, California Institute of Technology, George Mason, Princeton, and actually quite some more, Florida State. So there are quite a few people who have chosen that track before the track has actually been officially formed, because it's an exciting topic. You know, people, you know, it's interesting, really. I mean, I wouldn't have been doing that had it been even boring after all. Right? Because life is too short to do boring things, and it's necessary to make it entertain yourself and do things you enjoy doing. Right? It's really, really important. And if you have the real curiosity about why and how the society around you and around us runs, and why it runs the way it runs, what are the driving forces behind the ununderstandable or strange or queer behavior which you observe around you, behavioral economics offers you a broad perspective into these questions and the tools which are needed to study these questions in a rigorous way. So that's essentially what our profession is all about. And students will inevitably be involved in research projects which we're working on, again on our website, which I have cited above. You can find some of the topics which we are working on, but there are actually some more which are some maybe behind the scene for various reasons. But whenever you have an idea, feel free to comment to us and to share it with us, because good ideas never grow up or emerge or materialize in a single person's mind. They materialize between the minds. The good ideas arise in collaboration, in cooperation. And when it's a matter of research, it doesn't matter whether you are a full professor or a master student or even a bachelor student. Bachelor students can have excellent ideas which full professors have never came up across, never were able to come up with. And some good papers may emerge out of these things. We have papers published jointly with our students, of course, as many other people do. And yes, if you are interested in these things, you are welcome to join our laboratory as research assistants or in another quality. And we have actually some positions and some vacations which we can fill up, and we'll be happy to fill up with the members of this program. So just a matter of interaction. Let's talk about that, and everything's possible.
Yeah, I think it is perfect sentence to stop. Everything is possible.
Okay.
I think there is no other questions, and we just mostly use 1 hour. So yeah. I would like to say thank you to Alexis for so really interesting talk about what is behavioral economics and what are you going to study during your education in this track. And you see the contact of Alexei. If you have any questions about the peculiarity of behavioral economics, Alexei is open. If you have any organizational questions about how to enter the program or something else, Oksana Butko or me is also open for your emails. So we really hope to see you in September in our Pokrovka building. to meet you in person and to start this nice journey in behavioral economics. Okay. So thank you, everyone. Have a nice day, evening, or maybe night. See you later.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Bye.
Bye-bye. Thank you.